Hello all, and welcome to the 2020 Southeast Collaborative Online Conference. My name is Dorcas Davis, and I'll be your host for this session. And I'll be introducing Ms. Laurie Thompson, and the session name is Excel Tips and Tricks. This event is supported and sponsored through funding from the Library Services and Technology Act through the Institute of Museum and Library Services. Please feel free to ask questions and make comments in the chat or interact with other attendees and the speaker within the Hoover app for this presentation. And now I'd like to introduce Ms. Laurie Thompson. Thanks for being with us.
Hello, and welcome to one of my very favorite things to do in the entire world, which is talk about Excel. I have to be one of those dorky people who actually sits on the living room couch watching television on a Friday night and reading Excel books. I don't get a lot out of them because there's a lot in Excel I don't understand, but I do like it a lot. And I've worked with it for a long time now. And so what I want to share with you today is just some of the things about Excel that really fascinate me, the things that make my day a little bit easier. If I had to give this a new title, I wouldn't call it Excel Tips and Tricks. I would probably call it Selling Excel, because that's exactly what I'm going to try to do today. I'm going to show you how to kick the tires and look at the Excel and do wonderful things with it. And the first thing I want to talk about is autofill. Now, if you've been using autofill, hang with me for a moment or so, because I may be able to up those skills just a little bit. Autofill to me is like magic. When you put something into a cell in Excel, and I'm going to put the word Wednesday. I've got Wednesday in a cell, and I'm going to look at that cell and show you that in the bottom right-hand corner, the cell is not perfectly outlined. It's actually got a little box in the bottom right-hand corner. And see how my mouse pointer is an open cross? If I move my mouse directly over that little teeny tiny box there, then you'll see that it goes to a crosshair. And when you hold down your left mouse button and click and drag down, it's going to repeat Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, as far as you go. When you let up on your mouse button, then it's going to stop doing that. Now, it's pretty neat in that it does that down, to the right, to the left, and up. And this is actually, this is actually kind of the key to making Excel work for you much, much faster than you normally would. Now, Excel works by default with the days of the week and the months of the year. So we have March now, whether they're spelled out or abbreviated. And I can show you that. Okay. Now, it also will do some pretty incredible things if I come over here to Friday with the right mouse button. So if I put my mouse on top of that little autofill handle and I hold down not the left mouse button, but the right mouse button, I can pull it down and I can say fill days, which would give me the Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or I can say fill weekdays. So if your library is closed Saturday and Sunday, you can put that in there, okay, just with your right mouse button. The right mouse button does some other kind of funky things too. So if you always have a report due like on March 1st, you can come down with the right mouse button and tell it to fill months. So it will always say 1st of April, 1st of May, 1st of June, and so on. So that right mouse button has some pretty powerful things hidden behind that as well. Now, do you have a spreadsheet that you create or a series that you create often that you put onto a spreadsheet? For instance, maybe quarter 1, 2, 3, 4, north, south, east, and west. In Tennessee, we are divided into regions. So on my machine at work, I have the 9 regions listed. You can create a custom list, and you can do that by going up to File, and then all the way to the bottom. I don't know why they left this great big spot here open, but they did. Come all the way down to options. And then from this list of Excel options, and the options are tremendous, people, go to advanced. Now, go almost all the way to the bottom and click edit custom lists. So this creates lists for you in sorts and in sequences, and autofill is a sequence. So I'm going to edit and I'm going to say north, comma, space, south, east, west, and then click add. You see, I have put at least one other one in here, critical, urgent, high, medium. And click OK and OK again. And now when I come in here, regardless of where I start in the list, I can say north, grab my autofill and move it on down, and it will create a list for you. So if you have something that you use all the time to create a spreadsheet, there's your advanced bit on the autofill, which is really handy. It makes the day go by just a little bit faster. Okay. Give you a second to finish writing about that and tell you that when I had three children at home, I used to make their to-do lists, their job lists, their chore lists up while I was at work and I was thinking about it. And I would just write down what had to be done in Excel. And then I would list my three children and run it down and then sort that list. It was, they knew they got the job randomly. I didn't pick on anybody because they had seen me do it a thousand times. So, okay. Now, you'll see across the very bottom of my screen that I have the list of sheets that we're going to be working with today. Excel has worksheets within a workbook, and I kind of use the terms interchangeably. I apologize for that, but a lot of people do that. They get workbook and worksheet mixed up. We're working in a workbook, but we're also on a worksheet. Now, if I want to, I can look at those just across the bottom. But if I run out of room across the bottom, because some workbooks are pretty big, they're very large after a while. I see these two arrows here. They'll help you move through the list, but they will also, if you right click on them, show you your list of sheets. So if you run out of room, you can use that to show your list of sheets. The other thing I want to talk about while we're right here, I want to go back to that file and options and advanced. Okay, so if you are getting off work at 4:30 and you really don't want to do anything else, it's Friday afternoon, it's a beautiful day and you want to look busy, you don't want anybody to disturb you for your last few minutes of the day, come to options and advanced, because there's so much in here that you can just play with for a few minutes. The very first one here, when you press enter in Excel normally, you go down to the next cell, but you can go to the right if you're entering information across Excel. You can go up, and I think they did up and left just because they thought people would ask for them and they had learned to do right and down. So I think they just finished with up and left. But I do use right a lot, and I reset that occasionally. And then when I hit enter on my keyboard, instead of going down, I actually go across, which is handy. I'm going to go back and reset that because I don't want it to be that way at the moment. And Excel doesn't care if you do this 10 or 12 times a day. But when you want to look busy and you don't want to be doing anything really taxing, go on into there and read all of the options, because there are several hundred options on that screen alone, and some of them just might make your day. I'm going to move now to Flash Fill, because Flash Fill is an extension of the autofill, and it's kind of a neat thing because it separates things. And in this case, it's almost like a text to columns, which was an old feature in Excel. But the flash fill is a little bigger and a little better because it works with your autofill handle. And actually, the way I'm going to show you to use it, it works without the autofill handle being set up. So I have put in here a list of the first five presidents, and I'm pretending that this is a mailing list, and that I'm going to want to separate out the first name from the mailing list because you don't want to say in your letter, "Dear George Washington." You would rather say "Dear George," or perhaps "Mr. Washington." So you need those separated out. So I put the names in a list. Then I manually typed in George in one column and Washington in the next column. And of course I gave those columns a label because a week from now when I come back and look at this, I may not remember why I put those things in different columns. I always like to label my columns. And now I check to make sure that George is the exact same way it is in column B and that Washington is spelled exactly the same way. Now, when I come to the cell underneath George and I type the J for John, and why is it not working? Okay, we'll just put just come down and do it again. There we go. Sometimes you have to convince Excel that that's what you want to do. See, I've got John, Thomas, James, and James. So that's exactly what I want. I want the first names in that column. And so I'm just going to hit enter. And there will be the names in that column. Now, my column is very short. It's only five entries, but it could be 5,000 entries and it would still do the same thing. And now I'm going to do Adams, and it doesn't want to do it again. So I will show you the other way. I will right click and come down and say flash fill. And when I do that, it'll pick up the last names. Don't know why it has decided to be stubborn, but it does that every once in a while. And sometimes you just have to say, smack, I am the human, I am in charge. So there's the flash fill. And what Excel counts on is the same delimiter, a piece of punctuation, a space between these names of different length to separate them into the various columns. So that's what it's looking for, is that space. And it says everything to the left of the space goes here and everything to the right of the space goes here. So that's the flash fill, which was a relatively new feature. It's probably 10 years old. Now I'm going to move on to another sheet, which is sum. And here I have a very small spreadsheet. And I want to talk to you for just a moment about some of the other things on the screen that you may not have noticed or played with. And the first one I want to share with you is in the very bottom right-hand corner. And I mean, it's way down there at the bottom. Perhaps you have a spreadsheet that's just a little bit too big for the screen and you want to make sure that you get to see the whole thing. Or maybe your eyes are just tired at the end of the day. And what I'm going to do here is use that zoom slider at the very bottom right-hand corner of the screen and slide it up to make it just a little bit bigger. That's at about 150%, 148, which is close enough. And that makes it a little bit bigger, which is really nice to see, especially when you're watching a presentation like this. It's easier to see what's going on. So that's the first thing I want to call your attention to, is that zoom slider. We've already talked about right-clicking over here to see your list of sheets. Now I want to tell you a little bit about a feature that appears here just to the left of the zoom slider. When you have numbers and you highlight them, something very exciting happens down here. At the moment, I have count, max, and sum listed. And what that does is count the number of cells that you have highlighted, but only if they have numbers. It finds you the largest in that set of numbers that you have highlighted, and then it adds them all up. You haven't built a single formula, and yet you've got results down there in the bottom right-hand corner. The selection comes from a list, and you can right-click on it, and you'll see the six most frequently selected formulas in Excel. The average, the count of cells with numbers. So if you have some text mixed in there, you're gonna get just count of numbers. The smallest, the minimum, and the largest with maximum, and then the sum. I really, really like sum. Sometimes that's the only thing I leave turned on because I can look at a set of numbers and they're instantly added up for me. I just find that so helpful. Or I can go back and ask for an average and turn that on and highlight a set of numbers. I think that's incredibly useful and I use it all the time. Also on your screen, regardless of the size of the screen, you may have a column that's a little too narrow. It's just not quite wide enough to show you everything that's in the column. So in that case, you get a very mysterious and not very helpful error message. You just get a bunch of hashtags. And what those hashtags are telling you is, hey, I can't, now speaking as Excel now, I can't show you all the numbers that are in that cell. I'm not going to show you the first few and let you think that's what they are. I'm not going to show you the last few and let you think that's what's going on there. I'm not going to show you any of the numbers. So you have to go back and adjust your column width. And the way to do that is to go all the way up here between the letters that identify the columns. If you put your mouse right on the line that's between those two, you'll get a two-headed arrow, kind of like the people that bring the planes in, okay? If you go and hold down your left mouse button, you can either drag it all the way out, okay, make that column as wide as you want, or, and I'm gonna make it very wide, you can, once you have those two arrows, those offsetting arrows, you can double click that line. And what the double click does, it adds just a wee little bit more room to the column and makes that the width of the column. It finds the widest cell. It says, okay, we don't have anything any wider. And it goes all the way down regardless of how long the column is and adds just a little bit more room and makes that the column width. Now, if this bugs you, if you can't get them all the same width and you want them all the same width, you can also come up here in this area that surrounds the column label, the E, D, C, B, A, and right click, and there is something called column width. So my current column width is 11.14. And in column D, it's 12. In column C, it's 12. Well, that's better. If you want them all exactly the same, you can go back and set those. So you can go to column width, type in 12, then go to column width and type in 12, and all of your columns will be the same width. Now, rows are exactly the same way. You come out here and click, and you have to be on top of one of the numbers that identify the row, and right click, and there's row height. So you can set your row height. So maybe you want just a little more room between the column headers and the rows. So I come in here and make that like 18. That gives me just a little bit more Just a little header room there. Before Excel, there was Lotus. And one of the things that was very, very difficult to do in Lotus was to adjust the direction of your text. And so this remains one of those things that really impresses people. If you highlight your column headers with your text, and not the column headers that are up here that identify the columns, but the column headers that identify your data, and then right click, you can come down to Format Cells. There are half a dozen tabs here, but the one that I want is Alignment. And I can come in here and just click and drag, and that's the angle that my text is going to be on. In Lotus, this was very difficult, and that myth persists. And people think if you have done this, you have done something absolutely amazing and you are a true wizard at Excel. It really was just a couple of clicks. Okay. Also on this screen are a couple of other things that you might want to know about, which is wrap text, which makes it go down to the next line and not exceed the width of the cell, and shrink to fit, which makes it tiny so that it fits within the cell. And I'm going to click OK here. And there your text is angled. Now you'll see in a couple of these cells that we have a little red triangle in the upper right-hand corner. That's a comment. Think of it as a 3M sticky note right on top of your spreadsheet. So if I hover my mouse over that cell, I'm going to be able to see the comment. And my numbers apparently in the north for quarter two were very low. And it says here, extremely bad weather for three weekends. So my cells must have been off because of that. Here the comment says, a one-time conference really helped the third quarter number. So that's good to know. I can't expect that bump quite that high next year. So there's the little comment that's going to remind me of that. Now, I have seen comments used for various things. When circulation numbers were down because we closed for a couple of days for ice. We do that here in Tennessee a lot. We get a lot of ice. When they shut down for COVID, they marked the day on the circulation that they shut down for COVID and said, that's it, we're done. Sometimes people keep track of other data in there, although I don't really suggest that. I also have seen forms, and my favorite one was a young lady who was going out on maternity leave, and she was leaving another young lady in charge, and she went through a form that they filled out weekly, and everywhere where there was a number that had to be collected from somewhere else, she put a note on that little cell that said, call Mark at this extension and he'll give you this number about 3 o'clock on Friday afternoon. So she had all her instructions right there. And I thought that was just brilliant. So we had that opportunity. Now, everybody always wants to know how to build formulas in Excel. And this is a great place to take just a few minutes and talk about that. Again, if you're really, really comfortable in Excel and you've been through this, give me a couple of minutes and I promise I'll make it worth your time. So I want to total up the sales from the north in cell B8. All formula cells begin with equals. I can't say that enough. And after all the years I've been using Excel, I still forget that equal sign once in a while. It's just one of those things. Excel looks for the equals. It wants to know what it's supposed to be doing. Is it just recording data? Is it just holding that number? Or is it supposed to be doing something for you? And the equal sign says, do something for me. And I'm going to tell you what right after the equal sign. So all formulas start with equals. So I'm going to type equals and show you the long way around to build a formula. So you can click or type B4. And I don't want to move on until I point out to you that B4 is in blue and that the little dancing ants that are currently going around B4 are also in blue. I know they're called marquee lights in Excel. I like dancing ants better. And then we're going to type a plus sign. See, the blue line stays. And now I'm going to click B5 and notice that B5 is in red. Each cell that I select will be in a different color. And then I'm going to touch the plus sign. And now we're in purple. And now we're in green. That's my entire formula. There's quicker ways to do it. Must be a half dozen. But that's the long way around. And if you are just stuck for whatever reason, and you know the math you want to do, but you can't figure out how to get it into Excel, all you have to do is just type it out the same way you would write it out. Okay, B4 plus B5 plus B6 plus B7. Bingo, we're done. So I can go up and hit the check mark, and we're done. That added it together. Now, I can also go up and get a function. So I can go up. I want my southern totals here. I can go up and click the FX, which is Excel's version of insert function. I want to sum. There it is. I'm going to click OK. Now, every function, and there are several hundred in Excel, has the same basic layout. It's going to, first of all, give you the fields it wants you to fill in up here. It's going to give you the current total that it thinks you're going to end up with. It's going to tell you in bold that this argument must be filled in. That field must have something in it when you click OK. But it doesn't necessarily need to have something in number two because it's not bold. Okay. So at the moment, my formula is going to be right here. Equals sum C4 and then a colon and C7. And that colon means start at C4, end at C7. I'm happy with that. So I can click OK. Wow, that's a big number. Does it look right? Maybe. But one way I can check it is to go back and highlight C4 through C7. I have 245,430. And I can go back down here to the fields at the bottom, these quick results, and it will say 245,930. Hey! I built the formula right. It did what I thought it was going to do. And that's a good thing. Okay. So there's a second way to do it. Here's a third way to do it. I'm going to click on D8, which is where I want the result of the formula to land. Always be where you want the answer to be when you build your formula. And I'm going to go back to the home ribbon. And in the upper right-hand corner, on the far right side of that home ribbon, is auto sum. Now, auto sum is a funny-looking Greek E, should you not have your labels on the icons. Also, if you click the down arrow to the right of auto sum, you get average, count numbers, min, and max, very similar to what we have down here when we have numbers highlighted. I want a sum. I want to add this up. So I'm going to let it stay on sum. And when I click on that, it builds the formula in one click. Now, the rule that Excel has is I'm going to look directly above where she has asked me to sum something. And if I see numbers, I'm going to take those. If I do not see any numbers, or if there is a space or text, then I'm going to think, nope, that's not what she wants. And I'm going to look to the left. And if there's numbers there, no spaces and no text, then it's automatically going to grab those numbers. Well, that works in this case. If it doesn't get you what you want, you can always highlight the cells that you want. So you can come back up here and just click and drag. Okay. So it has what I want. I can say yes. I can either hit an arrow key. I can click this check mark up here. I can hit enter and it will do exactly what I want. So there's a third way to do it. Now, all of these formulas are totaling four digits directly above. Look what's in the lower right-hand corner of that cell. There's an autofill. I'll be darned. We're back where we started from. I'm going to put my mouse right on it. It's going to go from an open cross to a closed cross. And we're going to drag it across. And it's going to grab the numbers in the new cell in E8 and total those up. So just to show you that the auto sum will do what I said it will do, it will go up and then it will left. I'll come over here and total the quarters. So I'm going to click on auto sum. It's going to go up, it's going to find a blank cell immediately. Then it's going to look left and it's going to say, oh, look, there's numbers there. Maybe that's what they want. Yep, that's what I want. And there again is the autofill. So I can click on it and drag it down and it will fill in the numbers for me. I'm pretty impressed by that, to be honest with you. I think that's an incredible skill to be able to build those five formulas with just one. But this is even more impressive. I can highlight all the numbers that I want to total and a blank cell for the results. And this just blows my mind. I can hit auto sum one time and it puts all of those numbers in there. It does the formulas for each one. See, in C8, up here is my formula. It goes up and it shows me C4 through C7. Yeah. And over here in F6, it totaled everything to the left. Now, this is one of those things that when I found out about it, I was so happy. If you get a spreadsheet and somebody's given this to you and you have no clue what's going on this spreadsheet, hold down your control key and hit the tilde. The tilde is the key directly to the left of the number one. It's a little curvy thing. We don't use it in the English language, but they use it in Spanish quite a bit. So control tilde. And what control tilde does, it shows you where every formula is and what that formula does. And so the formula here sums up B8 through E8, and that's right. But you can look at a spreadsheet and say, oh my goodness, that's what they did there. That's where they got that number. And then control tilde to turn it off. It toggles on and off with the same combination of keys. And I love control tilde. When I first sit down with somebody and they say, this is just not working, that's one of the first things that I do because I want to see what's happening in the spreadsheet. So I think we have talked enough about formulas for today because really in just an hour, I can't show you a lot about functions. There's some new ones in Excel 365 that are kind of neat, but there's not a lot we can talk about without really blowing your mind. And there are other things that I want to show you. So I think we'll leave that for now. Okay. I have one more thing in the all about the screen category that I want to show you. And in order to show you that, I'm going to move on to this sheet called Pivot Table. This is a very long set of data. And when you scroll down through it, you lose your labels header at the top. You don't know what these columns stand for. One thing that you can do is click directly below where you want Excel to hold. So this is what they call freeze panes. And it's a lot like taking one sheet of paper and holding it up and then sliding another one underneath or over top of it so that you can see what you're looking at. So you can come up to view, and then on the window tab, and notice these ribbons, when people are giving you directions, the ribbons are divided into basic areas of function, and at the bottom of them, I don't know why at the bottom, I wasn't there the night they were drinking and decided that this would be a good idea. There's a label, and we're gonna look for the window label because that's where freeze panes is. And I'm going to say, freeze the top row. And nothing really happens here, except if you're really, really observant, you'll notice that there is now a slightly darker line underneath the top row. Okay. And as I start to scroll down, see that top row stays right where it should. And everything else is sliding underneath it. Doesn't hurt the sheet at all, doesn't do anything really majorly interesting, but it does make the sheet a lot easier to manage. Now, when you go back to freeze panes, you can toggle that off. You can do what they call unfreeze. The entire world thaws, but in Excel, we unfreeze. So I'm going to unfreeze. You'll also notice that there is a top row and a first column. So actually I could have frozen the first column. And then when I slide over, it slides underneath. And then you can go back and unfreeze and it will behave just the way it did before, which is perfect. So when I put this together, we talked about the fact that there is a way to chart in Excel that is one finger charting, as I call it. So this is a list of the world's fastest cars and the last pricing that I had on them. And I'm going to say that the Shelby does 257 miles an hour, and I want to compare it to the rest of the very fastest cars. And I was surprised that a Ferrari only went 205 miles an hour. I'm going to highlight the material that I want to chart. That's step one. Always step one when you're charting is highlight whatever it is you want to chart. And then, with great confidence, I'm going to raise my right index finger. I'm going to go to the keyboard and touch the function key 11. So F11. And I have a chart. It's not the world's greatest chart, but it is a chart. So you can start with that. And here we have the miles per hour and the name of the car and how fast it goes. Now, everything on a chart, and by the way, when you build that with F11, it creates a new spreadsheet at the bottom. So we now have chart 5 and charting. Every portion of a chart can be right-clicked and you can format it. So there's the chart title, which is MPH, miles per hour. I can say format chart title. I can put a border around here. I can put fill in there. I can change the text options. I can retype and call it speed in MPH. I can do whatever I want to that. I can even move it. I have to unselect it and go back and get it. But I can hold down my left mouse button and make that bigger. I can make it, if I can grab it, doesn't want to grab at the moment, but I can move it around and put it somewhere else, okay? Even these column headers, I can click one and then again, and then it will say format data point. And I can go over and make that data point a different color. I can say solid fill and tell it to be a different color, put a picture in there, put a pattern in there. So the key to do that is to click on it and then click again. It's not really a double click. It's more like a click and then click again. And then right click and format data point. Now, if I come out here, I can right click and do format chart area. And I can do the same thing. I can put a whole picture behind it. I could come over here to the axis label and format the axis. I can make that just a little bit bigger. I can change the numbers. I can put some shadow behind it. I mean, I can do all sorts of things on that. But the key to doing that is to right click. Now, let's say I don't like the chart at all. I click on the chart area and I say change chart type. So maybe that would look better. Maybe I decide that a pie chart would look better or a line chart would look better. Maybe some sort of bar chart or something would look a little bit better, or a column chart. And then I can decide what kind of column chart. So I like that a little bit better. Ooh, that looks a little more impressive. But then it took away my labels down here. So then I have to come back in here and add data labels. Okay, so evidently I just clicked on the one, which is fine. I can add a chart element. I can add axis titles. I can add data labels. I can add from the data table. I can add anything in here I want with add chart elements. So if you don't see it, there it is. You can add it in. Okay. So that's the first way to create a chart. I'm going to go back to my data that's charting. I can also, and just to make it a little different, I'm going to chart the make and the price. Now I highlighted the column that said make. Now I'm going to hold the control key down and highlight the column that says price in US dollars. And then go to insert. And in the little label that says charts, there are recommended charts. These are done by professionals. They look good. They're interesting. They're kind of a nice place to start. I can look at that and say, yeah, that'll work. And then I have a chart. And this one is a little bit more meaningful. But I do like it a lot. I'm sitting here looking at it like, oh yeah, that's not bad. So if I look at the chart area, change chart type, I can change it again. There are usually ways to go in and change your chart. To add some color to it, or you could do that manually. There's all sorts of things that you can do. And people will tell you to go ahead and go through all of this strategic charting information. Remember where to find it up here and do this and that. No, do it really simply. Set up your chart and right click everything. In the 20 plus years I've been using Excel, nothing bad has ever happened to me because I right clicked. It's very, very safe. And it will give you all sorts of options that you might not have thought about. So go ahead and all over the place, right click, be happy, right click, okay? So, and you can move your chart, you can copy it, you can chart something in Excel and move it to Word with a copy and paste or to a PowerPoint slide with a copy and paste, no problem at all. Just go ahead and change it. Kind of think if there's anything else I want to show you at the moment, and I can't think of anything about the charting. Remember the F11 or the insert with the recommended charts and right click everything. If you do those three things, you got it made. You don't really need to know anything else. Now I'm going to move across to pivot tables. So what is a pivot table? It takes a lot of data and it makes it so that you're not just looking at numbers, you're actually looking at information. You need a pivot table if you are tempted to go and get a sheet of paper and a ruler and a pencil and take that ruler and go down through those entries and make a tick mark on a sheet of paper. Okay, that's when you want a pivot chart or a pivot table. So here we have sales by date, by who it was sold to, the salesperson's name, where that company is, what they bought, how many they bought, and the total price of what they bought. So Nancy sold things here. She sold things down here in row 16. She sold a little bit more down here. So they're all over the place. It's just like at 9 o'clock, they sold this. At 9:15, they sold this. At 11:10, they sold this. It's not really data. It's more, it's not really information. It's just more data. So pivot tables scare people to death. And here's why. Because you get this far and you click on insert and you click the pivot table and it starts to ask you questions. Okay, I'm going to take it from this table. So it's going to put the dance and ants all around my data. Yeah, that looks pretty well, right? Yeah, it's got everything I want. Where do you want me to put it? In a new worksheet. That would be fine. And that's all it really needs to know for now. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. Oh dear. So now we have a screen that has this really bizarre looking diagram over here on the left. And then totally disenfranchised from everything else, we have the pivot table fields listed. Okay. So at the bottom of where we have the fields listed, we have filters, columns, rows, and values. The filters is going to do exactly what it says it's going to do. It's going to filter the data, and you can choose any of these fields to put in there. We'll deal with that in a minute. Rows is the one that most people tackle first, and that's going to list what's on the far left. That's going to be row headers. And I'm going to take the product name because I want to know how much of each product we sold. I don't care which salesperson did it, which country it was in, what date it was, I don't care. I'm going to take the product name and put it in rows. And now I have a list of every product that they sold right there. And over here, I'm going to take the total. And I'm going to put it in values because the only thing you can put in values are numbers. So I'm going to click and drag and hold total and bring it down. And now I have the information that I need. We sold $400 in anise syrup, $764.40 in Boston cream or Boston crab cakes. I must be hungry, Boston cream pie. Pavlova, $291. Outback lager, apparently nobody wanted the beer. Now I can go through and format all of this. You format it here the same way you format it everywhere else. I'm not going to take our time to do that. But what I am going to tell you is that now I can look at a filter and I can click and drag filter and put it above all of the sales. And I can say, okay, what did King sell? Well, King sold $13,703. And apparently he really likes pushing the, whatever that is, Côte de Blé. he's got somebody that really likes that. And he talks up the steel-eyed stout. So not so much the lager, but the stout. He likes talking about that, and he does a good job of selling it. Or maybe she, I don't know, I forget their first name. Now, I can filter all day and all night and look at different people. I can look at multiple items or multiple salespeople if I want to, maybe by selecting multiple items. Or I can get rid of that filter entirely just by taking it out. Okay. Do I want to know the quantity in next to the total? I might be helpful to know that. It might be better to take out or to leave the product name in there, but then to find out what companies bought which products. And so I can grab a field and bring it down here. And now I know that Bottom Dollar Markets bought an awful lot of Alice Mutton. And Ernest Handel bought a lot of Chocolade. All I'm doing is clicking and dragging fields. When we made that first pivot table, it only took us a very few seconds. And I'm changing it just as easily. So I can look at product name and perhaps country to see what's going on there. Or maybe I just want country and what sales we've got from each country. Maybe I want to know country and then salesperson. You can do that all day and all night. We export from our circulation software and libraries all over the state, and we can play with genre. We can play with the quantity that they purchased. We can play with the vendor that they purchased them from. We can do all sorts of things, and it just goes like that. It's so much quicker. I didn't want to share any of that data with you because I didn't have permission from any library to share their current data. So I didn't want to do that. So I grabbed this old data, but just play around with the pivot tables all day and all night. It's very easy to do. It's not a difficult thing at all. Your original data is still sitting there in the table. You haven't done anything to it. It will not update unless you go through a few hoops. You have to hit F9, I believe it is, to get it to update the data, but it will, you can update it. But it's a very safe thing to do. It's a lot of fun and it's lickety split. I really like pivot tables and I encourage you to play with them. Don't be afraid of them at all. So last thing I want to show you is printing. And I'm going to go back to the sum sheet. Okay. The sum sheet is a good one for us to play with because I can show you how to get a few things on there when you're ready to print. So when you're ready to print, I always like to highlight what I want to print. unless it's great big, and then you don't need to do that. It'll just take everything. Okay. And printing is filed under file and print. Okay. Now, if I were to turn that in with as part of a report, I would be rather disappointed with myself. I would want to put it in the middle of the sheet and not up under the staple. So that's the first thing I'm going to tackle, is where it's going to land on the sheet. And I'm going to do that under margins and come down to custom margins. And on the page setup sheet, see down here where it says center on page horizontally and vertically? Click that. And when I click OK, it's going to go to the center of the sheet. And again, that's under normal margins and custom margins. And under margins, center on page horizontally and vertically. Now, over on sheet, there's a couple of other things that I want to show you. First of all, you can click on grid lines, and it will print the grid lines for the area that you have highlighted. It will also print the comments as they appear on the sheet. At the moment, it's not going to print them at all, but you can say none, so you don't have any. You can print comments at the end of the sheet or as they are displayed on the sheet. Always very helpful. If you have multiple sheets that you're printing and you want to repeat the column headers, okay, rows to repeat at top, you can select those rows by clicking in that box and going back and highlighting. Now, I have a very small sheet, so it's not going to let me do that, but there's where you get that option so that it will repeat the rows at the top of every new sheet. Those are a lot of the options that people ask me for most often. And just with those two options, the print grids, okay. Now then, and center horizontally and vertically, you've improved the way it's going to print a whole lot. Now we also have an option here under print that says no scaling, which is the default, but you can make your data fit on one sheet. You can fit all the columns on one page, or you can fit all the rows on one page. Sometimes you just have that one row or that one column that won't quite get on the page, and it will shrink it down for you. So it'll take care of that problem. And that makes my life a lot easier too. I'm not into wasting paper, and I'd rather see all my data on one sheet of paper. And I don't want to hit print. I don't really need a copy of this. So that's what I wanted to show you today. And I hope it was worth your time. There's so much in Excel that really you can spend the better part of a week just looking around and playing with different things. There are millions of pages and thousands of hours of documentation on YouTube. If you have something that's really bothering you, poke around a little bit, give it a try. You're bound to find something that will help you out. Thanks, Laurie, Dorcas.
This was so great. I have so many notes. I don't know if you all can see, but this is so great. And thank you for being with us today. And I want to thank everyone for attending our webinar. And if you have any other questions, please feel free to reach out to the speaker or any other conference host using the Whova app. And evaluation will be provided after the conference session and the resources. And we welcome your feedback about the session and the conference. Thank you everyone for making it to the 2020 Southeast Collaborative Conference and making it successful. And we hope to see you all next year. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.